do the Provincial Parks Act. And so they did. And now we have the Provincial Parks and Conservation Areas Act. It's a damn good piece of legislation that says the first priority of our provincial parks and conservation reserves is protecting the ecological integrity of one. And that's huge improvement. And where did the idea come from? Well, it came from the government. When we slam them, we always try to leave that door open for them. Always, never close, always give them an out, an honorable out, and so that they can come back and be the true governors, wise political powers and others are our problems. A year and a half, the whole world changed. I guess it was, months go by, I can't remember, was the last report? Or the year before, I forgot. Anyway, within the last couple of years, I issued an annual report, we didn't get the media coverage. We had a good media strategy. We used it for years. We always had a good media strategy. It's on the regular big annual report. And yeah, it was okay, but it was a much, much modester media. And we started looking and we found out what's going on. Well, turns out, what happened, the big thing in the media, there's big consolidation. They closed down all sorts of media outlets. They laid off all sorts of people. They decimated all the press. Some people retired. We did frustration. And it just isn't for media coverage. To back to your question. So I had to redo my media strategy. And I have done so, and I'm getting more activity than I did. Not as much television, at least, to get, but that could change. But I got getting lots of things. But we completely restructured it in response to this new, and now other groups that come to me, my communication people, find out how we did it because they noticed that we've been able to. And by the way, now I issue 4 reports a year, and I blog pretty much every week. I tweet those blogs. I tweet this meeting. Mm-hmm.
And Facebook.
Oh. And it's entirely one of my blogs. Last week was picked up by Tyler Hamilton as a guest blog. I tweeted it. He tweeted me back. Gore, can I use that in my blog, which is really widely read? And it was picked up subsequently by the Calgary Herald and the Windsor Star. First time I think it's ever happened. The premier quoted me in the Legislative Assembly from one of the blogs. for my report, they do that all the time. The opposition or the premier, depending on what point they're trying to make, I'll always quote you. But from my blog, first time I think it's ever in the hands of me. Yeah?
This is in regards to the Lake Simcoe Protection Plan.
Yep.
Earlier this year, the MOE came out with a report in regards to the landfill in Orillia and a large leachate plume going into Lake Simcoe.
Oh.
However, I haven't heard anything about them forcing the city to do anything about it.
You know what? I don't very often get caught on a major environmental issue in this province. Certainly not one. I don't know anything about that. I really, Eric? I haven't heard about this.
Yeah, the garbage dump.
Yeah, I heard what it is. It's land and leachate going at step across from here.
Really,
it's
just right on the shore of Lake Simcoe.
Okay. City of Kingston had an active landfill. I think it was had a landfill. It was leaching into the river. Didn't do anything about it. Environmental Group brought a private prosecution against them. The private prosecution was picked up by the government, and they were convicted and fined. You can't. It happens that the leachate plumes get out of control and get away, but you have to take evasive action, and they're not easy to fix. But that's the law. So that would doesn't need a Lake Simcoe plan. That would be the law anyway. So the Ministry of Environment, if they say you should report, obviously you're doing something. So if there's a finding, then there would have to be some kind of response. Whether they would do.
No, there was no action.
No action. No response.
You flag that. I'll go back and we'll certainly be interested in seeing that report.
I know Kelly Plume, who just ran for council, she was pursuing that.
But know that it's something that has to be responded to, through what we call data and action by Ministry of Environment. It would be the city owns, I assume, since it really owns it, so that's what has to do something about the problem at this. And then, but, as I say, I don't know the specifics now, but that's the kind of thing that if nothing is done, like the example I said about done in Cambridge, that's when you can use it in a request for investigation. Say, what the heck's going on here? Why is there no action being taken? So that's the backup tool is the Environmental Bill of Rights. Because you're buried, we're on the stormwater stuff, and we know.
Well,
that is the plan. That does relate to, you know, those are challenges for the plan.
Apparently, the township refuses to do anything to upgrade those. They haven't applied for any funding, from the federal government, the $30 million that was made available for funding. And they just choose to ignore it.
Yeah.
So what can be done about it?
Well, what can be done? I mean, you first door to knock on is Ministry of Environment. And because that's ultimately down the enforcement thing, and the backup is your rights to file a request for investigation. And that's exactly it. But to find out what the ministry is doing first, because they may be doing something you don't know. You know, some of these, and I know and watch it on the plan. The simple plan has highlighted a lot of these stormwater issues, at least to be looked at. So it may be subject to something that's not being publicly discussed yet. So, you know, give them a chance to say that they know about it, they're doing something. But ultimately, if there isn't anything happening, whatever, if there is water pollution occurring, then request for investigation.
Can you say a little bit more about how these NGOs and your office can interact?
Well, I think I've been sort of, sprinkling it in, and mm-hmm. that is that, you know, the NGOs usually have issues and they're trying to pursue, and I always recommend you go, you know, if you're involved in processes, like environmental assessment processes, which you follow through, do what they want, do all the things, but if you come up with issues and become frustrated, if the ministries won't give you performance and you have a legitimate case, then use your EBR rights, right? And shake it loose. Gets the topic back up on the table, gets discussed, and that's what you want in many cases.
Did Site 41 ever approach your office? The people from Site 41, from the dump Site 41.
Oh, yes, you can see Site 41 all through my reports. Hey, I got Gold Hawk says I'm the guy. I got the ball rolling in Site 41. I don't know if it's right or not, but that's what Gold Hawk says. Yeah, I went back to Site 41 recently. Sorry. That's interesting if you want to just quickly on Site 41. Sorry. See, I used to be a district manager for MOE. Right? I've worked in some terrible jobs. Had a hard time holding on a job until I got the commissioner. But I know the inside, that ministry inside of that. And on the Site 41 thing, Garfield Dunlop brought it to my attention, about 2002 or 2001 or something like that. And we, you know, got on the mission right away. I said, you know, this is a very weird, something's very weird about this. And I don't do everything personally. I get too much work. I have the staff, and they do a lot of the research and stuff. But in that one myself, I was the most qualified person on the staff to get through the really peculiar history of that site and all the government documents that I'm going to labor. But it's a very unusual story at the start. And so I got all the documents together, and I did all the original work to find out what was going on, to find out that was a very bizarre process right from the start. So I know all about Site 41. We wrote it up that way back then and pursued it various times. They passed the Green Energy, Green Economy Act, and they expanded the powers of my office. Specifically, one thing that I was doing already, but they made statutory, is to report that I have to issue a special report to the legislature on the progress the government has made, or lack of progress, reducing greenhouse gas in the province, which they have committed. So the premier says, we will do an annual report on our success in reducing greenhouse gases towards our plan, our long-term plan. And the Environment Commissioner will be required to independently review and report on that. So I do that. So I oversee greenhouse gas reduction for the province on an ongoing basis. I move that report to the spring this year. But more significantly, we used to have a chief conservation officer was called, a position over a vice president position in the Ontario Power Authority, that looked after conservation of, promoted conservation in electricity. And in that act that was passed, the government ended that job and then moved that responsibility to me and made it not just about electricity, they made it, the law says the Environment Commissioner shall report annually to the legislature on the progress of activities in Ontario to reduce the use of, or make more efficient use of, electricity, natural gas, propane, oil, and transportation fuels. So, so they broadened the energy conservation concept, the efficiency concept, to all fuels. Now, there's lots of information on electricity, there's lots of information on natural gas. There's not so much on oil and not very much at all on transportation, for fuels and propane. So we have to be able to really look at conserving these things long term. We're still building the structure to see what, you know, how much of stuff we consume and how we report on conservation. But nonetheless, that's my challenge. And I can, so I report on initiatives that are happening in Ontario. I report on any targets. And there will be a report at the end of November on the latest on targets on energy conservation. That will be the next report. But then this is probably, I also require a report on, I love this one because I've never seen anything like it in legislation. It says, any acts or regulations of Canada, of the government of Canada or Ontario, that result in barriers to development and implementation of measures that reduce the use of or make more efficient use of energy. But I've never heard of a provincial level officer being, by law, required to report on the activities of the federal government. So I have that requirement in legislation. So. Wow. And I said, not only in the federal government, not only in Ontario, any bylaws of municipal councils, for those who involved in councils, that have resulted in barriers to increasing the efficiency of energy. Or any policies of the government of Canada, any policies of the government of Ontario, or any policies of municipal councils that result in barriers to reducing use or making more efficient use of energy. So, now, I can honestly tell you that I can't do all of that in any given year or any given report. Not with the six people that I got, actually five, on the energy efficiency side. So, but it's a big task. We will do some, and we will sector highlight different parts and different activities in this immense energy sector, and we will start to, we already started, and we will continue to pursue energy efficiency specifically in great detail. And it's a heck of a lot of work. It's really interesting, and it's very, very, very much ongoing. A huge part of my workload right now is to begin to understand. And it's interesting, this energy, if you think energy is messed up, it's probably because it is. And it's largely a very secretive organization. It's big in structure, big organizations, and lots of money involved. But they haven't been subject to very much outside scrutiny before, these big institutions. So I'm just a little mouse here against the elements. But nonetheless, the first notice that's come and asked our dad some of these questions and trying to get at some of these issues. It's really interesting, and I'm pursuing. So you'll see much ado about. Much of what you believe to be true about energy, especially electrical stuff in the province, is not. I can say that much. So, it's a great change we're in here. Yeah.
That's because everyone here, I think, in this room is interested in a number of different causes that you've talked about tonight. So, again, I thank you for taking your time out.
Results from the other night.
I thank Marianne for organizing this.
Thank you.
Mike, you forgot Amnesty.
Amnesty International.
I've written that on the, yes, Amnesty International, and Marianne Consoles here on their behalf. Mm-hmm. So thank you again, everyone, for coming. And we put this at transition all the time. That you know, you don't want to reinvent the wheel. There's you know, we talk about things we'd like to do, and then very quickly find out that it's already being done somewhere where we could help out with another group rather than trying to do it on our own. And you know, rather than trying to do the same things over and over again to connect people together is hugely important. I know even in the city of Barrie, our mayor-elect has talked about having citizens group, and I've already talked to him about an environmental advisory group that would hopefully consist largely of people from the NGOs that have
interest in various aspects or all of them. And I think that's very important at every level. And you're quite right. It is important because we don't need barriers between the groups, but we do need ways of getting people connected. And there was a lot of talk in the election about using social media. Well, that keeps coming up as a way for grassroots, low-budget groups to connect. Things like Facebook and just emails, you know.